Greetings, students. This is Dr. Tarpey. This video is intended to provide you some information and an example for working the crossover analysis that is associated with your cocoa price sensitivity analysis exercise. In this video, we're going to look at what essential data elements you need to collect for your crossover analysis, what variables you need to graph, and how you would calculate that crossover point, as well as how you would interpret that crossover point. So let's start with the variables that you need to have to do a crossover analysis. You need to understand, first of all, the two scenarios for which you're going to do the analysis. In our example, I have some made-up data here that I've taken from another exercise. We have scenario one and scenario two. You can associate this very closely to your assignment where you are looking at the two scenarios of purchasing cocoa from the cartel countries versus the non-cartel countries. So we need to understand our fixed costs for each scenario. In this case, scenario number one has fixed costs of $120,000. The fixed cost for scenario number two is $600,000. We also need to understand our variable costs. So our variable cost for scenario number one is $100 per unit of whatever we are considering. For scenario number two, the variable cost is $50 per unit, again, for whatever unit we're considering. Now, the key to doing a crossover analysis is looking at creating a data table. This is in order to create a graph for your crossover analysis. So in our data table, we need to set some unit numbers, in this case from a raw material, 500 units, 2,500 units, 4,500 units. You need to select some good increments of units in order to have your graph display correctly. And I'll come back and revisit that in a few minutes. So the lines or the data series that we need to graph are, as you can see in our legend, the fixed costs for scenario one, the fixed costs for scenario two, and then the total cost for each scenario as well. So what we need is we need a data column that has our fixed costs for each scenario. Scenario one, fixed costs for scenario two, which is nothing more than the data values that we talked about a minute or so ago. And then we need to calculate our variable costs for each scenario. In this case, our variable cost for scenario number one, we know that the per unit cost is $100. So if I have 500 units, at $100 each, that's going to be $50,000. And you can see the formula that's been used in Excel is taking the value of cell A8, which is our 500, and multiplying it by what's in cell B4, which is our $100 per unit. You'll notice the dollar signs that have anchored B4. The reason we use those dollar signs is if we're going to copy this formula down into the other cells, we always want to reference B4. We don't want that reference to change any. So we anchor that to what we term as anchoring Excel with the dollar signs in front of the B and the 4. So to create the variable costs for scenario number two, we go through the same exercise and put the same type of formula in. In this case, we're going to take the same units of raw materials, A8, and we're going to multiply it, in this case, by C4, which is the per unit cost for scenario two, and then we're going to fill that number down into our data table. Our total cost is rather easy to calculate. For scenario one, it's nothing more than the value of the fixed cost plus the total value of variable costs at 500 units. B8 plus C8, which is $170,000. We do the same thing for our total cost for scenario two. We add fixed costs in E8, cell E8, and we add our variable costs in cell F8 to come up with $625. Calculate your total costs all the way down throughout your data table. So now you have your data to graph. The way we graph this essentially is you're going to graph your fixed costs, your total costs for scenario one, and then your fixed costs and your total costs for scenario two. You should end up with four data series on your graph that looks something like the graph on the right here. Now, when you pick your raw materials or your unit increments, it's important to pick increments that are going to display the point where your total costs cross. So where these two lines, your total costs for scenario one and total costs for scenario two cross, that is your crossover or your break-even point or however you choose to refer to it as. You need to have that somewhere visible in the graph. So if I had gone from 500 units to, let's say I made this plus 8,000 instead of 2,000, and then if I carry this all the way down, you will see this is what I've picked. You can see when I change the raw material increments, I go up to 152,000, the crossing point is very low on the graph. Well, that does not make for a very good graph. So we're going to undo that, and we're going to create an increment. In this case, it's 2,000. Every 2,000 units is going to put the crossover point at least visible in the graph somewhere, if not necessarily in the middle. Now let's talk about how we calculate our crossover point, which in this case is $9,600. So, or 9,600 units. Essentially, it's quite easy to calculate that number. So the formula is going to be, you consider fixed costs first, you look at the higher fixed costs for your scenario, which is in C3, scenario 2, subtract your lower cost fixed costs, which is in B3, this will be 600,000 minus 120,000, and then you're going to divide that result by your higher variable costs, which is in scenario 1, that's in B4, minus your lower variable costs, which is in C4. Now, it's very important that you put these parentheses into your equation. If you think back to your algebra days in high school and the order of operations, if we take these parentheses out of the formula, you're going to get a vastly different number than 9,160. It's going to come out to 598,000. The reason being is Excel is now going to take first division and multiplication. So it's going to divide B3 by B4. It's going to subtract that from C3, and then it's going to subtract C4 from that result. And that's not at all what you want. So be sure that you are paying attention and have your parentheses in your break-even or your crossover calculation to ensure you come up with the right number. So in this case, the right number of crossover is 9,600. If you refer down to our graph, somewhere around the point of 9,600 units, you'll see where the total cost lines are crossing. That essentially means that at 9,600 units, the cost of using scenario one is equivalent to the cost of using scenario two. If you interpret that to read, if I have less than 9,600 units, then the cost for scenario one is going to be less than scenario two, and therefore scenario one would be the preferable option if I am producing less than 9,600 units. If I produce more than 9,600 units, in this case, you can see that the total cost line for scenario two is lower than the total cost line for scenario one. Therefore, if I produce more units than 9,600, then scenario two is going to be the preferable option. Now, the last thing to do is to calculate the crossover point in dollars. That's fairly simple to do. All we need to do is we take our 9,600 units, plug it into a data table, much like the one above. We know our fixed costs for both scenarios, fixed costs one at scenario one at 120,000, fixed costs for scenario two at 600,000. Our variable cost we know will be the 9,600 times the 100 per unit price for scenario one. It's gonna give us our 960,000. And then we take our $50, which is our per unit cost for scenario two, times the 9,600, and we come up with 480,000. So you'll notice that at the break-even point or the crossover point of 9,600 units, the total cost is exactly the same. And that's what we figured and calculated with our crossover formula. And that 1,080,000 should be represented on the graph, where the two total cost lines cross. Okay, so that gives you a general idea of how to create this crossover analysis for your assignment. Keep in mind that when you create a graph, you need to ensure that you have a graph title. You need to ensure that you have a legend that explains what the data series are. You need to have a title on each of the axes to ensure that the reader of the graph can properly interpret your graph and not need any additional information. These are all items that you can refer to in the grading rubric that will earn you points on the assignment. Okay, I believe that takes care of everything you need to know to do the cocoa price sensitivity analysis assignment. As always, if you have questions, feel free to reach out to me either via phone or via voicemail, and I'll be happy to answer your questions. Good luck and complete the assignment.